So we're going to put a pause for the cause and be right on time because we're going to spend a lot of, and the rest after this is basically some much more examples. If you want, you can print those if you want to have some more examples in hand. But we're going to get into what I would say the fun stuff, right? It's all fun.
Yeah.
And Brian is known for that.
It's going to be a carnival in here.
That's right. So with that.
All right. So, Brad, I'm going to ask for your help. Everybody, if you look at your first of all, my name's Brian Gable. I think I've met most of you in person. If not, I know we've spoken on the phone quite a bit. So we have met virtually. So if you would, go to your email. Sam, I believe, on Friday, emailed you a PDF. And in that PDF is an outline of what I'm going to be covering today. How many of you guys are able to pull up this PDF that you guys, that Sam got? Okay? All right. How many of you guys didn't get it? No? Well, we can do that. You can make a few of these, but I'll show them online too because it's got some nice supplements. If you haven't gotten it, don't worry, you can get it, and I may even modify this, but on Friday it should have been sent to you by Sam, but it's okay if it wasn't. This is what I'm going to cover today, and again, my name is Brian Gable. We have Debbie and Megan here. Debbie and Megan are from School Data Solutions. Yeah, thank you very much for coming. And these, they're here to kind of look, watch me and also provide some input and correct me if necessary. And also share with you other things that are happening. But we're going to be pretty fast today. We're going to go through and cover a lot of ways to look at student data. And because I tend to go kind of fast and some people can't quite follow along, and I'd like all of you to follow along if you can, I've created this. All right, so I put this together pretty quickly on Friday. And what this is just what I'm going to cover. And you see there are links in here. And if you click these links, it'll actually take you to a video that I just recorded it on my computer at my desk. So if you're kind of like, oh, what did he do there? Oh, I don't worry about taking notes. You can endure me and my cough presenting this stuff up here, okay?
All right. Students that you want to focus on,
I hate my own voice. All right. So all of that is in here. Each of these has a link to these areas that I'm going to cover. So you guys are all set, and you don't have to worry about trying to take notes or feel like you're going to miss out. All right? All right. So without further ado, let's go ahead and have everybody open up and log into Homeroom. If you don't know how to if you don't know how to log into Homeroom, you can follow me up here. All right? So log in the Homeroom, the easiest way is to go to staff link on the KSD homepage. And then IT has this really nice area now and see employee tools. Employee tools. What's going on?
Nothing.
You click there. Okay. I actually have this recorded too. Also, IT is here and they're recording as well, so if you prefer to follow along in the IT session, that's fine. And then H, look, the only thing under H is Homeroom, right here. So if you click that, you'll get to the login page. Now, Brad said, today we have Brian here and we're going to capitalize off of having Brian here. Great, capitalize off it, but know that I'm always here. You guys can always reach out to me if you need help with Homeroom or anything. Data related, and I'm just not going to disappear after this session. Now, to log into Homeroom, you simply type your username and password that you would use just to log into your own district computer. They've standardized that, so it makes it a lot easier to get in. Is anybody having trouble logging into Homeroom at this point? If you do, if you are, raise your hand and we have some folks that can come around and help.
Hey everyone, here's how to log into Homeroom. Go to the Kent School District homepage, click here on Staff Link, and then go over here to Employee Tools. And then under H, you'll see Homeroom. Click it. And to log in, you'd use your district username and the same password you'd use to log in into any machine in the district.
Now, Homeroom has a really nice tool that allows me as a presenter to present data without showing students' names, which is great. So I'm going to go, and you guys can't do this, but I can. I'm going to go into demonstration mode, and I'm going to turn this on. And this basically hides all students' names so that I'm not showing you students from another school and violating any kind of privacy. All right. Okay, so let me first talk about the strengths and weaknesses. All tools have strengths and weaknesses, and it's very important in Homeroom that we understand what its strengths are and what its weaknesses are. Okay? Its number one strength is that it's easy to use. If you've ever pulled data from Skyward, you know it can take a long time. If you've ever tried to pull the same data from Homeroom, it's very fast. Number two, it's great for day-to-day exploring of data. If you're just looking and you want to see, you know, hey, how is this group of kids doing? You know, just offhand, let's take a look. It's good for that. Number four, it's really, one of its strong suits is it's excellent at looking at individual students' data. If your counselors at your school are not using Homeroom right now, I would suggest making sure that they know that it's available and that they know how to log in. Because it's excellent for looking at one student, looking at all their scores in the past, seeing where they've went, seeing what services they're involved in. Finally, it's really good for viewing multiple assessments in multiple subjects. iReady scores, SBA, IRLA, all of that is in there. I mean, EOCs, all the stuff that you're looking at, all the district and state assessments are in there. Okay, let's talk about its weaknesses. Homeroom produces data and charts which are not reproducible over time. What does that mean? That means that the data in Homeroom changes every day. When Skyward data changes, it changes. When a student drops out, that student is gone. Or moves, you can't see that student anymore. It's hard to pull up that student's data. You can, but it's not easy to do. And any charts that you produce in a year from now, or even 3 weeks from now, probably will look slightly different. Not a lot different, but they'll look a little different. So you need to be aware of that. Finally, its other big weakness in my mind is that it cannot combine multiple grade levels of proficiency. Like, what's the percent match standard of my third through sixth graders, or of my seventh and eighth graders combined? Grade level is baked into the assessment, which means you have to look at one grade at a time. Okay? Now, Homeroom may change some of these things in the future, but right now, these are the major weaknesses. All right, let's go ahead and kick this off. Is everybody logged in? Who isn't logged in yet? Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to start by creating some custom student groups in the student groups widget. Now, Homeroom is designed that it has all of these widgets. Now, a lot of you can't see, most all of you shouldn't be able to see this CAA, CIA, but you should be able to see the directory, the logins and links, lookups, assessments, groups, risk, maybe risk indicator viewer, and data extracts, all right? So how many of you at your schools have ever wanted to create a nice group of students that you just want to have a group of them and you want to look at just their test scores? Okay? All right, I'm going to show you how to do that right now. There are two ways to do it. The first way is a smart group. So let's do that first. To create a group in Homeroom, see this little button right here that says groups? If you click that, that'll just zoom you down to this, what we call, it's a widget. This is a window within a window. All right. Now you can see that I have created a lot of student groups here, but most of you probably haven't created anything yet, so this is blank. All right, so what we're going to do to create a new group is we're going to go to, any questions? We're going to go to filter and create. So go ahead and click on filter and create. And let's say, just for this purpose, I want to create a group of African Americans who are below or well below standard on their SBA, this SBA, the Smarter Balanced Assessment. And I only want, say, current seventh graders. So current seventh grader, African-American males who are well below or below standard on the Smarter Balance. We can easily create that group in Homeroom. So I'm going to show you the reason why I've added so many things there, African-American male, seventh grade, is because you can use multiple filters, and I want to show you how to do that.
Hello, this is Brian in the assessment office. I'm going to demonstrate creating a student group. Many of you probably have groups of students that you want to focus on, and you want to go ahead and determine how many of them are at your school, and you want to look at their performance over time. And before we can look at all that data, we actually need to create the student group. So that's what we're going to do today, actually in the next couple minutes. So to create a student group, what we're going to do is go to the Groups widget, which you can get to pretty quickly by clicking on this button. It says Groups. And then you can see there are two tabs in here in the Student Groups widget. In the two tabs, there's My Student Groups, which are custom groups that I've already created, and I'm actually going to add to this long list. And you do that by actually clicking on this other tab for Filter and Create. So let's just say that I'm at a middle school, and I'm interested in looking at all the students who were in seventh grade last year, and they scored below or well below standard on the Smarter Balance. All right. So what we're going to do is you're going to add a filter group, and first you're going to want to maybe put in enrollments, and I'm going to find a middle school. Douglas Middle School. And I'm concerned about 7th graders. All right. Now notice the number of students that comes up here. This is kind of serves as a sanity check. So far, Douglas Middle School in the 2015-16 school year, 7th grade, there are 323 students. If I get rid of seventh grade, you can see I have 650 students. So as you add filters or specify in this filter what you want, naturally the number of students is going to decrease. So this is a nice way to do this. These students right here, if you click on them, I'm in demonstration mode, but you would be able to see all their pictures here, and you would be able to see all of these students. Okay. So I'm not done yet. So now what I need is I want these, and maybe I also care about African American students. So we're going to add another filter, demographics. Notice that it just moved my enrollments filter off to the right. Now I have my demographics filter, and I can choose African American students. I can choose more. I could do Hispanic as well. You can see as I choose more, the number starts decreasing. So I'll just do African American for now. In addition, I wanted to know which of these students scored below or well below on their Smarter Balanced. So I need to add another filter, assessments. Note that the enrollments filter is still over here. It's off to the side. It's being hidden. Here's the demographics. This is my third. And now I can select the assessment. So I'm going to find SBA grade 7. And I didn't tell you if I was interested in math or English language arts. Let's say I'm interested in math. And I can select the status. So there's below and well below. Note that I can't select both of them, I actually have to add another SBA to say well below is what I want in addition to below. So you have to type that in. Math. And I also want the well below students. So now I have 24 students who are at Douglas Middle School in seventh grade, African American, and on their SBA, seventh grade SBA in math, scored below or well below. Okay, so I have three different filters here. I have three different filters, and I can add more filters if I want. But you can see I only have 24 students in this group. So let's go ahead and save this group. And when you save, you can elect to save this as a smart group or as a static group. It doesn't say static here if I click no, but a smart group essentially changes as students enroll and unenroll from school. So you never have to go and change that. It runs every day and it finds out who those students are based on their status in Skyward and the grades that are that the assessment office puts into Homeroom. So I'm going to just name this African American below and well below on math SBA. And maybe I want to add that it's seventh grade. Okay. Now, I don't think you guys will be doing all of these filters, but I just wanted to do it just to show. And when you click save, it says the smart group is saved. Now, after you create a group, it's always good to refresh. You can click this refresh button. And then you should be able to see it then in your My Student group. So here it is, seventh grade, AA below and well below on math SBA. If I click that, I can see all the students that are at Douglas Middle School. And this actions button is quite nice. If I want, maybe I can, if I want to edit it, I can click edit and go back to this. I can also print this list of students. If there's someone else that uses Homeroom and I want to share this list with them, I can copy this to him or her. And you would do that by clicking that button and then copy users by search and then typing somebody's name in there. Tim. And you know, these are other people in the district that have Homeroom access, and I can click that and they would be there. And I could say copy. And when they log into Homeroom, they would be able to see this seventh grade AA below and well below on math SBA show up in their student groups. I won't do it, but you get the idea. Likewise, you can just download an Excel spreadsheet of these kids. If you click that, the download options button comes up, and you know, I've always told people this analogy. This is like a waiter coming, and he comes to you and he says, "Hey, what else do you need in addition to the entree that you ordered?" The entree meaning this list of students. Do you also want their gender, ethnicity, maybe their native language, their grade level, their status, special education, ELL status. Do you want all that? And you can click yes to the ones you want. And when you click OK, you'll get this list of students. You open it up. Bear with me, it's opening up. And these are the students. Now keep in mind, these are all scrambled names, so nothing is nothing's confidential here. It's all made up names. And this would simply be the list of students that meet that criteria that you set in all your filters. Okay? All right. When you create a My Student group, you can also use those up here in the assessments widget. Choose a student group. You can find that those student groups will be here. The one that I created was 7th grade AA below and well below on math SBA. So you can work with those in the assessment widget as well. All right. Hope that was helpful for helping you figure out how to create your own customized My Student Group in the Student Groups widget.
Next, I want to show you guys how to create a static group. And let me just check the time here. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to defer to my video that's in the agenda that I sent you to allow you to learn how to create a static group, because we simply just don't have the time.
Hello, this is Brian in the assessment office, and I'm going to show you how to create a static group today. Now, most of you are probably going to be creating smart groups, but one thing about smart groups is, I'm going to go to the groups widget, click on groups, is the smart groups only give you these filters that allow you to create those groups. And a lot of you at your schools may have interventions that that are not in Skyward and therefore not available here in Homeroom. For example, an after-school program that only you know about and you have maybe 10 students in them. So what you want to do in this situation is you want to create a static group. And this is a group that's specific to students that you know are in programs that you want to track and that are not easily pulled by these filters here. So to create a static group, you simply get to this button that says New Static Group. It's a plus, and you're going to name it. So I'm going to name this After School Program, and we're going to save and edit. Now, you can add students to this group by simply typing their name, such as Smith, and you can try to find them and add them in here, and they go over. But this could take a long time if your groups are 20 or more students. So another way to do it is to upload a CSV of the students that you care about. So what I'm going to do is go down to the Data Extracts Manager, and I'm just going to pull a list of students from a school. So let's pretend Chelan Elementary, and it's we're going to just pull maybe all students. That would be all students, Chelan 1516. And when I upload this file, when I get this Excel spreadsheet, I want other ID to be in there, because that's what Homeroom is going to use to populate your list. And I'm just going to download this whole file and say OK. And what it does is it gives me a simple Excel list of all the students at the school. OK. Now, this is always a good place to start with, you know, having a list of students. Here they all are. I'm going to enable editing. I like to see all the information in all my rows by highlighting A to J or A to whatever it is that you want. And you see when you move the cursor in between, you could double click and it automatically spaces all of the data or in the fields. So maybe you know, hey, you know, wow, what a coincidence. These first 10 students are the students that are in my group. So say that's who's in your group. Then what we're going to do is we create a CSV file of other ID, which is what Homeroom uses to load these students into a group. And you see what I'm doing is I'm just deleting rows and columns that I don't need. So this is what my file looks like at the end. Note, this allowed me not to have to type any of these other ID numbers in. And then what you're going to do is you're going to save this file. And I'll just save this on my desktop for now. and I'm just going to name it example loading student group. And I'll just save this. Well, hold on though. Before I save it in this Excel, before I save it as an Excel file, I actually want to put this, save it as a CSV. Do you see this CSV MS-DOS? If I click that, then that should allow me, that'll save it as a CSV. A CSV file is simply a very simple Excel file that only saves the data within the cell, and it's asking you, hey, are you sure you want to save it in this very limited format? Yes, I want to continue doing this. So it's saved. Now I'm going to close this. I don't know why it does it. Does it ask me if I want to save it again? I've already saved it. So anyway, so now that I have this list of students saved, and I can actually go back to groups here, and I can find that after school group, remember this after school program? It's right here. I clicked it. There are no students in the group. I didn't add anybody. And I can click on actions, and it gives me this list of things that I can do. And one of it is I can upload students to this group. See that? So if I click that, it says, hey, must be a CSV. Well, I already warned you about that and showed you how to save it as a CSV. So now I can choose the file. And remember, I put on my desktop with all the other garbage that I keep on here. And here's example loading student group. Remember this? So I do that. It's in there, and I'll upload it. Success. So that's been uploaded. Remember, I had 10 students in there. Let's just check to see if that's the case now. Now, hold on. It says no students in this group. That's because I need to refresh this little window. And if you refresh this window and you go to that after school program, voila, you'll have the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Maybe I only brought 8 students. I thought I had 10 because the first two rows were not students in that file. But these are the same. These are the IDs. These are the students that belong to those IDs that I loaded. So there you go. That's how you do it. And then finally, do you see how these other groups I've made, they're little cogs next to them? See these little circle things, these little cogs? This one doesn't have a circle cog, doesn't have a cog, which means that it is not a smart group. It's a static group. These cogs mean that these groups are smart groups. So they change as the data in Skyward changes, depending on the filters used to create it. Okay? Sorry, this was a bit long, but hopefully it was helpful for you. Thanks for listening.
What I'd like to move on to now, though, because this is really the important stuff, is pulling student-level assessment data. This is one of Homeroom's strong suits. All right? There are multiple ways you can look at assessment data, but let's just go ahead and I'm going to navigate you to the assessments widget. If you see this button right up here and you click it, it'll take you to the assessments widget. This, again, is a strong suit of Homeroom. Before you look at assessment data, Homeroom asks you, for whom do you want to look at assessment data? And it's asking you that in this first drop-down here. After you answer that question, it asks you to choose the assessments you want to look at. But first, we need to choose the student group. So if we click here, there are two ways you can select the students you want to look at. You can look at my student group, the students that you just pulled. Let's go ahead and do that. My student group, find the group of students that you selected and just click them. I, just for display sake, I'm going to choose student groups here. This is a generic way to select the students. It's probably the preferred way to do it, so you get all the students at your school. First thing you're going to do is you're going to select the year. What class, what cohort of students are you interested in? You can go back in time if you want, but I'm just going to select the 15-16 school year. So this school year that just finished, let's look at students from this school year that just finished. Okay, you guys, I'm going to go ahead and I'm pushing forward here, and I'm going to show you I've chose my group. I'm looking at some of your computers, and it looks like you guys are pretty far ahead, so that's great. So I'm going to catch up with you. I do want to talk about ways to choose an assessment set. You can look at scores of one assessment if you just use this assessments button here. If you want to look at multiple assessments, you can choose assessment sets, which actually I've created for you, and so has the ELL department. And if you say, you know what, I don't care about your assessments, Brian, I want to make my own assessment set, you can also do that here.
Hello, this is Brian in the assessment office, and this tutorial is going to cover the assessment widgets, but specifically we're going to look at looking at more than one assessment. And this really is the gold mine within Homeroom, and that has saved a lot of coordinators and principals, APs, a lot of time. So if you click on the assessments button up here and you take it down, you can see this is where I left off in the tutorial I did right before this, which was focusing on one assessment. Now we're going to look at assessment sets. Now, in the last tutorial that I did, I actually looked at fifth graders at Jefferson Elementary School in the current year. So after you select that student group, you can go to assessment sets. And these are assessment sets that our district office has put together for you to make pulling data a bit easier. Now, you're going to find three different assessment sets for fifth grade. You'll find the ELA, the fifth grade ELA, the fifth grade math, and the ELL department has their own little ELL assessment set here. So you can look at data pretty quickly, multiple scores within a given subject area for that grade. Let's just look at math, so fifth grade math. If I click this, it's going to pull up all the assessments that people are caring about right now. They may not be in the order that you want, like this is, but right now we see people are going to care about the smarter balanced assessment fifth grade, which is here's the overall score, as well as the 1, 2, 3 different claims. They're going to care about iReady in grade 5, so here's the winter, fall, and the spring. They're probably going to care about the smarter balanced for the previous year when these fifth graders were in fourth grade. That's this. And they may care about a couple iReady scores in their fourth grade. So there are a few things about this. We can change the order of these columns. Maybe you can click here for advanced ordering and sorting, and you can move these around so that we have maybe the most recent to the least recent, winter, fall, math, fall, and winter. Okay, and then click done. And these columns are ordered a little nicer. It looks better. Likewise, you can, if you don't want to reorder, you can also sort. Maybe I want to sort. And the way that this works is you sort first on this column, so you can view by descending order. And then if there's a tie in score, you can sort by descending order here. Really, you just need to do a couple here. And gives you the highest performing student, as well, all the way down the lowest performing. So again, these names are scrambled. They don't mean anything. Now, some of us don't really care so much to work with data in this format. A lot of us would prefer to work on it in Excel, and there is an option for that. But first, I just want to cover a few other things here. This advanced filtering is kind of interesting. It does hear all your assessments, and it kind of just, you can get rid of the well below performers, for example, in the SBA summative math if you want. By clicking that, it fades, so it'll get rid of those students that scored in that area for you. Likewise, this gray area is the most interesting. This is no score. So if you have students that didn't take the test or are enrolled but didn't take it, you can turn these on. And this is nice to turn these on because you actually see students that didn't take a test at all. So at least they're on your radar. I recommend doing that so that you don't miss any students, because these lists can be incomplete if you don't include students without a test score. Let's see if there are any that popped up. Well, it looks like everybody did take a test. And if a student only took one of these, they would still show up here. The next is you can edit active assessments. So notice I had, for the grade four, I had fall and winter. Maybe I care about the spring more, so I want the print to bring the score in. But the shortcoming of Homeroom is you can only see so many of these, so we got to get rid of one of these if we're going to bring in a new one. So I got rid of the fall. That's the oldest assessment. And I'll go ahead and click Save. And now we have the spring and winter here. If I don't like that order, I can change the order. Whoops. I can bring the spring over here, so it's winter and then spring. And this is looking better for me now. Now I have most recent to the least recent. Okay. So now what we're going to do is we're going to explore this button right here, which is download this widgets data. This is where we can get all this data into Excel. So if I click this, a waiter comes and says, hey, I understand for your entree you want all these test scores, but in addition to the student level data and all these test scores, what other information about the students do you want? The thing is all the sides that come with your dinner are all fresh. That means they're all today's values. So if you're ever pulling data for students 2 years ago or 1 year ago, and you're choosing these sides, these, you know, additional pieces of information, such as their English language learner or special education status, these will be the status as of now when you're pulling this data, not what they were 2 years ago. So this is a great example of how Homeroom is not a system of record for data. It changes every day. So that's just a caveat to be aware of. Okay? But for the most part, since these are students are pulling right now, these should be their values right now. And we're going to say okay. And it says, hey, your download has started. Wait a moment. Here's the assessment set. It pops in here. Now I'll open this up and I'll show you what this looks like. Now, get this to open. All right. First thing you're going to see is it's in a protected view. So go ahead and click this for enable editing. You can see that all the attributes that I wanted, the ethnicity, grade level, 504 status, or all these are in here. And then you have the scores. Here's the way it does is it merges all these cells and tells you, hey, this is the SBA summative. And there's a score here that's under it. You have your score, you have your level, met standard, subject, school year, and administrative name. You can probably stop this video right here if you want, but if you want to learn some Excel shortcuts, you can watch what I'm going to do. So this just says score, and this has the actual name of the assessment. So I may say, you know, I want to sort this data, and, you know, before you sort it, you may want to rename score what the actual name of the test is. And maybe I don't care about the reasoning claims. You can see all the assessments are in here. But if I don't care about the claims, I can delete these. You know, I may just only care about which assessments these are. So I'm just renaming these real quickly. Hierarchy Math Spring. I'm just copying that. Pasting in here and copy this. I already math overall winter. Copy. Paste. Anyway, you get the point. So I'm naming these because I am going to sort. I'm going to sort ultimately on this second row. And here. Paste here. Okay. And maybe ultimately SBA, some mathematics, I don't want it to be the same name. This is the 2015 test. And this one over here is the 2016. Okay. So now that I've named these columns with the actual test name, I kind of don't need this first row anymore. So I'm just going to delete it. And I still know what everything is here. Now, what I like to do is a custom sort. So in a custom sort, I click up here in this, see this corner cell up here in the top left? I click there and it highlights everything. And then from there, you go to your home menu and go over here to sort and filter. And you can do a custom sort. And I can choose what I want to sort on. And unlucky for me, it's given me these column names as A, B, C, D. I don't want that. So I'm going to cancel out of here. I'm going to instead highlight all of this stuff. A short trick in Excel is if you highlight the row that you want and you go over as many columns as you want, you can hit Shift and Control and down, and it will highlight the whole area that's workable. And then let's try this one more time. Sort and filter. And let's see if I can actually see. Okay, so now it's giving me the names of what's actually in the cell. So maybe I want to sort first by 2016 SBA, and I want to sort from largest to smallest. And then I'm going to add a level of sorting, and I'm going to sort next by the previous year's SBA, 2015 SBA. Sort from largest to smallest. Hit OK. And look at this. It's sorted first by this. And then it sorts by 2015 SBA. So that's kind of nice. One thing that's annoying in Excel is that right now is that when I scroll over to the right, I lose my students' names over here. So maybe I don't want that to happen. And also if I scroll down, I lose my headers up here. So to aid that, what I do is I find an area of the Excel spreadsheet where if I pinned it down, I don't want this to move and I don't want this to move. If I pin this down, if I freeze this pane, then I'll be able to see the students' names as I scroll off to the right, and I'll also be able to maintain these column headers. So if I go view and then freeze panes and freeze pane, it freezes that. It freezes this pane, so when I scroll down, my rows still stay. My first row still stays. And see these names? If I scroll off to the right, those names stay where they are. So I can easily look at students' names and work with this. Okay? All right, so that is your Excel tutorial, in addition to showing you how to look at multiple test scores in a given grade. Okay? Hope this was helpful, and feel free to give me a call if you have questions.
Okay, but first let's look at one assessment. So if I want to look at SBA scores for these seventh graders, maybe I'll look at math. So if I click on that, good, these names are still scrambled. This is a view of one assessment. Now some of you I can see on your computers, this is what you're looking at. It gives you the highest score at the top. And as we scroll down, the lowest. Also gives you the ranges of below standard, well below, below, met standard. And there's no one who did above standard here. But if you hover over the performance levels, if you have a question about the color, you can hover over these and you can see all the levels that exist on the test. If I'm only interested in well below, I can unclick all these other levels and just look at the well below. If I want to create a group of students, I can quickly do that by hitting this plus button right here, which will create a student group of only these students. Okay?
Hey, Brian.
Yeah.
Is there a way to go in? So, for example, he's going to look at his classes, but he has one eighth grade class.
Yep.
Skewing his results.
Yep.
So how can he take that class out?
Yeah, so he can take that class out if he goes and he creates a student group of every single teacher minus that one teacher, and maybe minus that one period or whatever.
Well, like if he's just looking at his as a teacher, he shows all just his five class periods.
Mm-hmm.
But he wants to check out his seventh grade.
Solo, yeah, he could actually specify in that student group the student group widget.
He would.
Well, there. Yeah, what you can do, I can show you in this area here in the student groups,
right.
If you choose a subject,
right.
Say math, we can choose a teacher,
which we did.
You know, and then you actually see the periods in here.
No, we did, but one class period is an oddball class period and it skews its results, so he wants to look at all of them but that class.
Yeah, and this only allows you to select one of those before it collapses, so you'd have to create a student group.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. All right. Now, guys, let's look at this, because this is extremely valuable, what I'm going to show you. Do you see this district view button right here? This took me a while to find, actually. I didn't know about this the first month I was learning about Homeroom. Click on this district view button. And you'll notice another tab opens up, and it'll actually, here's your school. And it'll actually break down the performance, showing the numbers of students scoring at each of the four levels. Now, district administrators can do this for all schools, but you will only be able to see your school. If you don't like counts of students, you could click here for percent, and it'll give you the percent of students scoring at these levels. Now, it's important to note this. You guys all go to OSPI's website to look at data, I assume. The data that you see at OSPI's website will not match what you're seeing here. The reason is OSPI uses a different set of business rules to define how they say who met standard. For example, if a student skipped or refused to take your test, they would count in the denominator in OSPI's business rules. They would be in the denominator of total students accountable to take that test. Homeroom doesn't know who refused the test. It does not count those students in the denominator. Okay?
So if kids are new to the district,
yep.
And like maybe came from out of state or out of country,
yep.
They wouldn't count in this. And that would give us like the students we have in October, we can look at that and it would look different than the students we have in December.
That's true. If a student came from somewhere else and came in and took the SBA at another district and came in, and you want that student score, contact Carol Johnson and she'll put it in there. She has to go get that score.
But it
would show up in Homeroom, so when you're looking at that assessment data, it may be calculated in your percent met standard, even though you didn't have that student that year, in the previous year. Yeah. Well, no. Assessment data at this point, and I emphasize at this point, is loaded by our office. Just because it's in Skyward doesn't mean it goes into Homeroom. That could change in the future, but right now Carol Johnson loads all of the test scores.
So this doesn't automatically
upload them to Skyward? Not the assessment data. The assessment data is loaded by the assessment office at this point.
The main reason it doesn't pull directly from Skyward is Skyward's a little more simplistic. It's just giving you the overall score in those pieces. And by us loading to the assessment office, loading all the scores from the overall score file, they're able to get the strand data, the clean information, and the additional details that just wouldn't be necessarily in that Skyward assessment piece.
Yeah, and that's just an understanding.
To know where it's coming from. So it's a little harder to keep track of.
All right, one thing I want to show you is to see this group by button. This is a very valuable button as well. Once you're in the district view area, use your group by button to actually look at the counts or percentage of students scoring broken down by, say, their Federal 7 code. And again, you can toggle back and forth between counts and percent. It's nice to look at counts because you need to understand that there's only two students here and two students here. There are only four American, Indian, Native Alaskan students. So this is another way to look at your school's data in Homeroom. This is for one assessment, okay? So you can also do genders. You can do English language learner, special education. I want to touch upon this really quickly. Look at all of these ways that they classify this. Currently on, currently off, has ever been on, has never been on, was on, now off. This is just how Skyward data, it's entered. So we need to be aware that most of us are only going to use currently on or currently off. Probably not going to use these three. Okay? And these are not mutually exclusive groups. In other words, anybody who's currently on, one student here could also be, currently off. A student in currently off could be here. Was on, now off. Okay. Great, great, great. Shall we move on to multiple assessments, which is really the strong suit of Homeroom? For multiple assessments, I recommend using assessment sets. And the ELL department and I have set these sets up to appeal to most people in the district. For example, these are seventh graders. Maybe I want to look at seventh grade math or seventh grade ELA. Let's look at ELA for fun. If we look at seventh grade ELA, this is going to give us all the assessment scores that we care about. Most of us do. We have SBA, we have iReady in grade 7, we even have some iReady in grade 6. But for whatever reason, these are not in the order that I want them to be in. Maybe I want the most recent tests on the left and I want the least recent on the right. Well, you can change that by seeing advanced ordering and sorting. If you click that, you can rearrange these so that you can have the seventh grade SBA on the left and some of the claims on the left for the seventh grade SBA. Put the sixth grade stuff further on the right. iReady winter, fall, spring, winter, fall, claim 7. Spring. Okay, so I just organized this so that I have the student's SBA score leading, and then here are the 1, 2, 3, 4 claims of the SBA in here. And then I have the spring in grade 7, their winter grade 7 iReady, and their fall. These are the iReady scores. And then here's SBA from last year. So this is pretty cool, right? I mean, you have SBA from last year, SBA from this year. When you start pulling this data, you can see this of your incoming students. You can actually see this data, and you know that may or may not be used to help with SIP goals, depending on how you want to use this. All right. Now, how do I look at students coming into your school? Does anybody know how to do that? I'm just looking at seventh grade students, but don't you guys care about sixth graders coming in? Do you guys care about that? Okay. So if you click here, I'm gonna refresh this. And I want to look at, you guys care about students who, because you don't know these sixth graders now, and they're coming in. So if you go to student group, you choose current students, choose your school, Cedar Heights Middle. And if we scroll down, look at this. Current sixth graders attending Spokane, this is the made-up school, it's really Cedar Valley, in 15-16, and current seventh graders. Well, we care about those current sixth graders. This is the group you care about. Go to assessment sets and look at their sixth grade ELA. So you can find this for your own school, and you could see these students who are going to be showing up at your doorstep in September, okay? All right. So you better believe that this is going to help you know those students. You're going to know who these students are and what they've done before they've come to you. This is nice. All right. If you guys are like me, you don't like to work within a window. Homeroom annoys me a little bit because they have all these windows within a window. Excuse me, Megan and Debbie. But do you see this? It's not easy to work in this, right? So we want to pull this data out and put it into Excel file. And I already saw that Heidi did it over there, and many others done it. But do you see this little button right up here? It says download this widget's data. If you click that, again, the waiter comes up to you and says, hey, I know you want all these assessment scores, but what else do you want on the side? You can add your sides to it, and then click OK.
Where's the
any questions? Open. And here you go. Now, all the Excel files that I get from Homeroom always have this thing that says, hey, enable editing. Yes, enable editing. So you can see here at student level data, you have all the sides, the gender. I've had English language learner. Here's a little trick for some of you. If you highlight these columns, you notice you can't read everything in there. It's all kind of cramped. If you highlight these columns like this, I'm just going to do it for these. And then you see when you hover your mouse between each of the letters, G, H, you see how it changes? Do you see how that cursor changes a little bit? Well, when you hover it in between any two letters and double click, it automatically resizes everything so you can read all of the information in there. Yeah. Oh, okay. That's good to know. I did not know that. All right, so here we are. After I pulled this data together, right here, do you see this download this widget's data? That's what you click. And then the file will open as if you, it'll appear down here as if you downloaded it from the internet, okay? Okay. Now, if some of you in SIP planning, if you need this kind of, if you need folks on your team to have this kind of access, talk to me later about it, okay? If you need people on your team to be pulling this student level data and helping you analyze it, just chat with me. We can probably change your permissions. Yep.
So, as an administrator though, for my SIP team, if I create it and I share it, they've got access to it. It wouldn't block them out?
If you, I'm not sure, is it true that you can't download an Excel spreadsheet, you can't download a widget's data if you're not an administrator?
That's not what I said. I said the all the access that you're asking of the pull, so for instance, sixth graders coming.
You're right.
So on. You can't as a classroom.
You can't. But what I did is I made sure that everybody who was invited to this meeting had their permissions upgraded to specialist, so you guys still don't? Okay, well, talk to me afterward if you can't see everybody. We'll get you upgraded. Okay. Now, in my video that I've made for you, I show you a few Excel tricks and I as far as sorting and ordering data. So watch that video if you want. I don't have time to cover those in this session, but in the video session, I show you how to sort and work with this data. Okay? In this format. Okay. Any questions so far? I want to take a pause. Yeah.
You might get to this later, but if you want to input your own data into it,
yes.
Can you just pull data from an Excel spreadsheet that you've already created?
You mean like assessment data? Yeah. Like you have your own schools?
Like
you certainly can.
Assessment data in an Excel spreadsheet,
yep.
Can you just pull it over easily?
Well, you have to create the assessment first.
Okay.
And so what you do is you just tell Homeroom, hey, I'm going to be loading these scores in.
Okay.
Here are my thresholds for meeting standard. Here's the colors I want to assign to it. See, like, there are colors here. You can choose your little color scheme for your one assessment, right? And you can load that data in there, and it only is going to show up for your school. That's more advanced, and I was going to work with people individually on that,
okay.
If they want to do that.
Are there some good directions for how to do the user-defined assessments?
There are. They're good directions and good videos in Homeroom. Let me just show you that. That's actually a good point. What if you want to learn more? What if you say, no, Brian, he didn't really teach me that much in this training. I want to learn more. Well, if you scroll up to the top, do you see logins and links? It's this button right here. It's this. All of you have Homeroom video tutorials link. And if you click this, not all of these are made with my voice and my cough, which are in your thing that I sent you. But you will get to the Homeroom's website. And forget these promotional videos or the demonstration videos right now. And just, do you see the how-to videos in Homeroom? These are some nice videos that show you how to do a lot of cool stuff. So if you want to earn your PhD in Homeroom, you're going to watch all these videos and follow along with it, okay? You only get basically a bachelor's if you watch all the videos I sent you, all right? Maybe an associate's. So, I have actually worked with people at Homeroom and I've written script for some of these assessment videos, these widget videos. So some of these I've written for them, and then they got their top guns to like actually do all the video work and speak it all. All right. So there, that's again at Homeroom Video Tutorials. Any other questions before we kind of take a natural break here? All right, let me just demonstrate for some of you who don't know Homeroom, one real powerful strong suit of Homeroom. Because when we come back from our break, I'm going to show you how to look at assessment data over time. Don't worry, we'll get to that. But do you see this lookup tool in Homeroom here, in this widget? Go ahead and go to that lookup tool in Homeroom and just type the name of a student at your school. You can even type their first name only. Now, once you type the name of a student, you click that student, this will come up. Now, it looks a lot more exciting on your computer. You should see a picture of the student. I actually used this when I was proctoring for the Smarter Balance test to like check students' IDs. But when you look in, when you pull up one student, you'll see their picture, and it'll give you some pretty basic information on the student here. Now, this is not a good student because it's a guardian. Okay, here's a student, and does everybody see this this magnifying glass? The magnifying glass opens up, if you click it, it opens up another tab in Homeroom where you can see the original information you saw about the student, but you can also see their schedule and grades. It'll open up a gradebook viewer where you can not only look at students' assignments, but you can also look at their grades. Do you want me to go back? So here's the student lookup tool. You type the name of one student in here. And after you type the name of that student, like Smith, there's a magnifying glass right here. You click that magnifying glass. And it'll take you to the actual student's. There's a tab that is dedicated to that student. And again, you can see a lot of great information here on him or her. This assessment's with, just like in Homeroom, you can have all the buttons here show the different areas of the student that you can look at. My favorite, of course, is assessments. If you click on the assessments, you can see all the students' grade, all these students' scores on assessments. You can look at them by school year, or you could look at them by the actual year. So if I want to look at it by subject area, say math, this shows all the students' scores on all the assessments that we have in Homeroom. So this is an easy way to pull up a lot of good information on one student in Homeroom. We live in an era right now of data where we can actually look at data. We look at students coming to us and see what their history has been, see where they're growing. We all know, any of us who have been teachers know that cohorts are different. One cohort that I've taught in high school, I used to be a high school math teacher, could be completely different than another cohort. The chemistry of students is different. Cohorts are just different. So this part of the training is going to focus on looking at assessment data at those individual cohorts, so those individual students that come in. And three ways to look at it in Homeroom and look at it easily. So whether or not you guys use this, want to use this to create your targets on your SIP or not, it's up to everybody in this room, but I do want to share this with you. Okay? So the three ways basically look at to illustrate student assessment data over time, and these aren't just the only three ways. These are the three ways that I like. So you're getting a little bit of a biased presentation here. The first is a snapshot performance. We're all familiar with snapshot performances. This is what percent of students, seventh grade students at your school met standard? And, you know, next year, what percent of seventh graders met standard? So we're just looking at that. It doesn't track one student or a group of students over time. It's whoever took the test, that's who we're looking at, okay? The least sophisticated way to kind of look at trend data in Homeroom. The next is longitudinal view. This is a more sophisticated way to look at data. If you want to look at performance over three tests, or maybe four tests, what test would you want to look at? I-Ready Fall, I-Ready Winter, I-Ready Spring, SBA, and maybe even SBA in the previous year. I'm going to show you how to do that for groups of students. That's a more sophisticated way to look at data. If you want to select all those data, all those assessments, and one student didn't take one of the assessments, but he took the others, he's not going to be included in that. It's only going to include students who have taken all the assessments that you put in there. So I'll show you an example of that. Next is, we can't pat ourselves on the back if we see students increasing in proficiency at our school. Because in a high tide, all boats rise. If we went from here to here, we're not going to celebrate that unless we can see what others have done, right? What if the district went from here to here, right? So the third way of looking at data, which is adds another layer of sophistication, is look at your performance, the performance of your students in context to the district. Because we all talk about gaps, right? Oh, we got to close the gap. We got to close that gap. What's the gap? Well, we'll have to figure out that out later. But for now, we'll just maybe say it's the district average. All right? So I'm going to show you these three things right now. These arrows come down to apps in the data extracts area, which create graphs for these things. And we're going to go through each of these three ways to look at student performance. And if I lose you, know that you can always listen to my voice talking about this here on this video. There's a link.
Hello, this is Brian in the assessment office. I'm going to show you three ways to illustrate student assessment data over time in Homeroom using three of my favorite data extracts. The first way is a snapshot performance, and this is looking at it takes into account any student who took the test within a student group. If you go to the data extracts area in Homeroom, you can get this illustration using the app called Assessment List Percentages. Let's give an example of what this will give you. This graph right here is is the performance of all fifth grade students attending Jefferson Elementary School. Now I'm going to emphasize this. This is the student group, all fifth grade students attending Jefferson Elementary School during the 2015-16 school year. So this graph, all of these bars here, only contain students that are current fifth grade students attending Jefferson Elementary School. And obviously you can see the performance over time increasing here in the current year. And this first one is from the previous year. So this is the previous year's SBA. This is the current year's SBA. And these three bars right here are iReady, are the three iReady assessments, the fall, the winter, and the spring. Now, real important to note are the counts of students here. You have 57 students who are current fifth grade students attending Jefferson Elementary School. 57 students here too. 56 students here. 53. Notice the numbers going down. And then finally 51 students. So what this says is that of the 57 students, roughly, or of the students who were of the fifth graders that were attending Jefferson Elementary, 51 of them had scores for the SBA in their fourth grade. And this is what they're, these are what, this is the distribution of their scores. Okay? So, the weaknesses of this is that, you know, we don't really know whether there's a total of 57 students who are fifth graders. These could be different students, unlikely, but it could be, these could be different students taking these tests, you know. It just so happens there are 57 students who took it, but maybe there are 65 students at the school. And so each of these bars we cannot guarantee are the same students. Okay? So this is again assessment assessment list percentages. The next way you can look at data is a longitudinal view. This is a performance of a cohort over time. Now you can see this, you can get a view of this using the longitudinal cohort assessments, which also can be found in the data extracts area. All right, now let's take a look at what this looks like. Here's an example of a graph that this would produce. This is the same Jefferson Elementary, same fifth graders, same bars, except for look. There are it already tells you that there are only 48 students included to make this, all of these bars. So the same 48 students are in each of these data bars. So this is looking, this is really a nice way to look at data because you're dealing with the same students over time. You're comparing apples to apples. Okay? Now, this is a good way to look at data. It's a better way to look at data than before, but in a high tide, all boats rise, and we may pat ourselves on the back looking at this performance. Hey, we're getting better, but better compared to what is the question? Well, that's the third way to look at data, performance in context. So basically, this gives you the performance of a cohort over time. So it takes, it uses this cohort way to illustrate data, but it puts the data in the context of the district. And this can be found in the data extract cohort assessments comparison to district. Let's give an example of what this would look like. Here are the same assessments for Jefferson Elementary in 2016. And this is the same, these are the same assessments, same students. There are If you click on these bars, and I can't do it here because this isn't in Excel, you'll see that there should be the same number of students, the 48 students, as in the other one. But we can see that this dotted line has been added. And this dotted line is the performance of the district. So what we're looking at is, in iReady, for example, we want to see this is the gap between these fifth graders and the district. And we want to see that this gap decreases over time. And we do. We actually see that it not only decreases, it disappears in the district, and the school's doing better than the district. Here, the school's even furthering its distance ahead of the district. So this, in fact, is extremely good data for this school. Over here is the SBA performance of this school compared to the district. And when you compare it to the previous year, you can see that it was beating the district, but now it's beating it even more. So this really is the gold standard to look at assessment data in terms of quote unquote closing the gap. Okay, I'm working with School Data Solutions to see if they can improve the way that we can illustrate this by using student groups. This is definitely a better way to look at data. Okay. The next few tutorials will show you how to actually generate these graphs in the data extracts area of Homeroom. All right, thanks for listening.
Okay, so I hate my voice, so I'm gonna turn this off. Okay? All right, here's where we left off. Now, because this is SIP, and you know, you guys already know your seventh graders, they're gonna be eighth graders next year, but you don't know your sixth graders. So let's each of you, we're gonna look at your incoming sixth graders right now. All right? All right, I'm going to cancel this student out. All right, you see right here, see extracts, this button extracts. This takes you to, all the way down to the bottom of the page, into what I feel is the most confusing area of Homeroom, but potentially one of the most useful. I actually, when I learned Homeroom, I was like, are you kidding me? Look, there's a window within a window within a window. I hate working in Data Extract Manager like this. So, if you're like me, you want to just breathe deeply, and you want to use this button right here. It says Full Screen View. Each of you, go ahead and click the Full Screen View. And what it does is it just opens another browser, you know, and it makes it a lot bigger so we can see all of these little boxes in here, and you don't get the window within a window effect as much. Oh, data extracts is a powerful tool for viewing and saving data. Okay, I'm going to X that out. Now, here, this is like data extracts, this whole big window here is like Nintendo. And each of these boxes is like a Nintendo game. Now, we all played Nintendo or Atari or whatever it was when we were younger, and we knew there's some games we like more than others. Likewise, in data extracts, there are some apps that are more useful than others. Some apps are terrible. Some are quite good. The three that I showed you up there are quite good, and I'm going to show you how you work those. So let's start with the first one. That first one is called Assessment List Percentages. So you see if you can find that one, Assessment List Percentages. They're alphabetical. And then notice here real quickly that each of these video games kind of tells you what you're going to get with it. You know, like with this video game, you're going to get a chart, and you can also get you can actually download the student level data, see the XSLX. This one that I like, unfortunately, doesn't have this X. I kind of wish they all had this Excel, so you could, if you had questions, you could probe into the data to see what's making it up. But this one only has a chart, okay? So go ahead and click Create. And we're going to create a graph that shows your incoming your sixth graders who are rising to seventh grade, the ones you don't know yet. So first we've got to select our student group. So if you click that, you can either select a group that you've created by yourself, like I just showed you how to create those groups, or we could just do a general, more generic student group. So let's just do a general, more generic student group. And I'm going to say 15, 16, current year. I'm going to choose a school. Jefferson, Lewis. Okay, I'm just going to choose a Douglas Middle School. All right, now, again, does anybody remember where I go to find my incoming students? Yeah, current sixth grade attending Douglas or the middle school in 15-16. So let's click that. All right, now, this is the fun part. I applaud School Data Solutions when they allow me to do this. When you click assessment tests, I love when this window comes up because this window to me says I can put in multiple assessments, and I like that. So what are some tests that we want to see from these sixth graders who are coming to us? Anyone? Eye ready? Let's just stick with one subject. So eye dash ready. Let's look at math, okay? What grade though? Sixth grade, right? So I just say I-ready, math, GR6. And I'm going to go ahead and put these assessments in there. We kind of care about these, right? So let's go fall, winter, spring. What else may I want to see? SBA. SBA. I type SBA, GR6. Math, right? Let's put that in there. What else may I want to see? How about their fifth grade SBA? Why not? Fifth grade SBA, let's put that in there. See, I just said SBA space GR space 5. Yeah. Now, I'm a little particular. That's a good number of tests, right? I'm a little particular about this. If you click anywhere off of that into the white, the box will disappear. I'm particular about the order of the assessments because I like to see them in the order, the least recent to the most recent. So you can actually drag these guys around. Like, for example, this grade 5, I'm going to maybe put this over here. This is the first one I'll see. And then fall, winter, spring, those are in order. And then I have the mathematics grade 6 here. SBA is the last one. So earliest to the latest. Is everybody good? All right, now let's take a look at these kids. See this views? Click views and run now. All right, this is kind of cool. So right here is SBA when these kids were fifth graders. This is the first year of the SBA. Here's their fall, iReady. Winter, iReady. Spring, iReady. Hey, look, nice growth here, huh? And then this is their SBA summative. This is grade 6. Now, this is kind of cool, right? I mean, you can see these sixth graders actually are doing better. Look, from here to here, more of them are meeting standards. So this could be some information you could use to think, well, where are they going to be over here? Another year down. Where do we want to take them? So this is a way to look at a group of students. Now, pay close attention to what I'm going to say now because you need to understand this detail. Do you see right here it says current sixth grade students expected to attend Northwood Middle School during the 16-17 school year? These students, there are 289 students here that make up this bar. Here there are 288, 286, 284, 278. What's happening here? Attrition. Why? Because some of these students were not here this year. Some of these students were not here in this previous year. They're new. So this also just shows you, I'm going to throw this out there. Ready? Think about this. What if there are really 500 students in your 500 students upcoming sixth graders, and we are in a district that didn't care about assessments, and only half of them took it, half of them didn't? The way that this works is roughly half of those, it's possible that these 289 students could be completely different from these 288 students. So in other words, these may not be all the same students, unlikely, but they may not be the same students over time. In my graduate work, you would never look at data that is not longitudinal like that. I would want to know that a student here is also in here and here and here and here, because I want to see that growth over time. But of course, the more assessments you add, the less likely that's possible, especially at more challenged middle schools, right? So, where there's more transition. So just keep that in mind. So this is one way to look at data. Let's move on to the second way, the longitudinal way, okay? Now notice, I got this tab that says create here. Does anybody have questions about this, first of all? Questions? If you have questions, just holler them out, okay?
Brian?
Yeah.
I thought you had said at one point maybe it was about the assessment sets, but I thought you had said that the students would not be included in your if they had not taken all the tests.
The student in that assessment sets widget, if a student hadn't taken any test there, they would not be included, but you can get them in that list in the assessments widget. And I'll show you how to do that later. Come again with your question, because I don't think I understood it.
I thought you had said that if a student hadn't taken all five of these, they would not be in any of the results.
In this one. Oh, no. In this one, they would be included if they've only taken this one, but not these others.
Okay.
In the next graphs, I'm going to show you what you just said is the case.
All right.
Okay?
This wasn't a cohort, that's why.
This is not a cohort. You see no cohort mention of anything on this graph. Now, is it likely that these 289 students, that most of them are not these 288? Probably not. But it's just a caveat. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, next. Do you see over here? Click new. Click new, and it will take you back to this screen. And don't worry, you can always go back to this one so we could look at this. But we're gonna look at this data from a longitudinal perspective. Okay. So if we cruise down here, we'll find. This app, it's called Longitudinal Cohort Assessments. If we click Create, it opens another tab, and we're going to do the same thing that we did for this guy right over here. We're going to enter the same assessments and the same student group. So go ahead and do that, and I'll do the same thing up here. Are you guys with me? Okay. Now let's go on, let's graduate from that snapshot view and let's get to some longitudinal assessments. Okay. First thing to note about this is, look, it says longitudinal cohort 273 students. Very important. This number, 273, represents the number of students in all of these bars. The same 273 students took all of these assessments, and so it's comparing that group of students over time. It's looking at their assessments over time. So this is a more scientific way to look at progress of a defined group of students over time. How many were in that other one? 288, right? Well, we know that 273 took all those assessments. If I got rid of an assessment, this number would increase. Like if I got rid of this one, we'd probably get more students here. But this is still nice to see, and we are seeing that similar growth and similar growth both in iReady and in the SBA. Okay? Questions? Is that pretty self-explanatory? Everybody's kind of quiet. All right, are we going to give ourselves a pat on the back for this data? We can't celebrate, right? Maybe other people have all grown faster than we, maybe the test has gotten really easier, and for others, maybe other people have stronger growth over time. So for me, this doesn't really mean anything. What we have to do is let's look at that gap. Let's see how we're doing compared to the district. All right, so let's look at the third way to look at data. And School Data Solutions has not satisfied me yet with this final extract. And so because with this final extract, we can't pull incoming students. We can only pull current students. So what we're going to do is we'll look at seventh graders at your school, because they're going to be in eighth grade next year. We'll choose seventh graders as opposed to looking at incoming sixth graders. I wish they would do that for this next one, but it's not possible yet. So this is a tool we can only use at this point for current students that are at your school. So click New. Notice, look, we got a nice collection of graphs here. We got these two tabs. Now we're going to look at, going to do New, and find this one. It's on the right side. It's called Cohort Assessments Comparison to District. It's on the right side. Does everybody see that? Comparison to District. Let's click Create. It's opening a third tab. And go ahead and enter the school, Douglas Middle. School year, 15-16. Select grade. These are going to be, if I do sixth grade, nothing should show up, right? School data folks? No way, right? There's no sixth grade at Douglas Middle School.
If there isn't one.
Yeah, okay, so we're just doing seventh grade. And then we're going to select the assessment. Choose the same ones you did before. Oh, did I choose sixth grade? I didn't mean to do that. You guys, I have baby brain right now, and I'm moving, so I'm really sorry. Okay, can I move on? So you guys, I've selected, this is a seventh grade. This is the middle school current year, seventh grade, and I've selected all the seventh grade assessments, the iReady and the SBA, as well as the sixth grade. These kids' sixth grade SBA scores, that was before they came to your middle school. Okay? So let's go ahead and look at this. So it's kind of the same set of data, but we just increased it by one grade level, because this app will not let me use incoming sixth graders. All right, here's what we get. This graph looks a little different. It doesn't break down the levels like the other one did. But let's take a look at it. Here's the SBA for your seventh graders. Here's their SBA in the sixth grade. Here's their SBA in grade seven. What do you notice about these two SBAs? What do you notice about, what's this? That's the district average. What do you notice about this and this? What's that? Yeah, everybody dipped. This is iReady. This is iReady, so these are kind of different tests, but they tend to tell the same thing. But what I'm asking you is to look at SBA. Here's SBA for grade 6. Here's SBA for grade 7. Just looking at this and looking at this, what do you guys see here? Huh? The district seems to stay the same, right? Around 52 or so? What happened to these students' performance here? This is the school. This is sixth grade. This is when they were sixth grade, and this is when they came to seventh grade. What do you notice? They lost something over the summer because, look, this one's up here, and this one's lower. But if we're naive, we're going to say, hey, you know what? They're losing. They're going down. This is not good. A lot of times there's a transition in seventh grade. That's a hard thing for kids, to open lockers. So what we have here is we got, what I would look at more is look at this. Look at this gap. This is between the district and your school. This is where they were, but look at their gap. They had a big gap above the district here, but in here, that gap shrunk. So these kids were doing better than the district average, a lot better than the district average here, and they're still doing okay. They're still beating the district average, but that gap has shrunk. This is neat data to have, right? Not only that, but it's all of these are the same students. They're the same students. Now let's look at iReady. How have they done on iReady compared to the district average? It looks like they've maintained their gap. But the point is that these graphs help you digest that information of how these kids are doing over time and relative to the district, okay? Okay, do you have any questions about this? Okay, it's 10:15, what's that? It's by the group of students. So let's pretend these are Meeker Middle. These are your current seventh graders and their performance over time. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any questions about that? Does anybody see anything in the data that they want to share, like maybe something they didn't know before this session, before they saw these graphs, something they didn't know about their school? Okay. Well, if nobody has any questions or anything that they want to share, I feel like I'm not doing a good job because when you're doing a good job, people have questions.
It's summer.
Yeah. Okay.
So I want to jump in real quick.
Brad.
So
I'm here and awake. You're good.
So I want to jump in here if I can and just really want to think about the absolute need for the technical piece. But I want to go back to the M before we go between measurable and motivate. And I've had the pleasure of working with, I was just telling Tammy at break, my science team when I was at one of the schools, and how to use inquiry and things of that nature and data to push. And then ran across one of our, again, Abbott. I've been doing Abbott for well over 10 plus years. I say all that to say, as we think about this, and we know that schools can't do it alone, I really want us to think about sharing and empowering the use of data. So, talk about motivation and goal setting. How do we share that? So, one of the questions I have for everyone in here is, what data would be meaningful and purposeful to students? We started a campaign as a school, and it was called Know Your Numbers. And it was the students' responsibility to know their numbers. And it wasn't about creating anxiety and stress. It's saying, this is who you are on paper. part of our mission and strategic plan as a district is preparing for your future, whether it's college entry or career, whatever, there's going to be some level of numbers you're going to have to know in order to improve. Make sense? So, for example, we had little things on this. We had, at that time, we were using SRI scores, right? And we're telling you have to grow 50 points. So make that goal, and then there is the how, right? And so we begin to share that. And again, this is the part where we start to take that SIP off the shelf, and it doesn't become, quote, the SIP team. It becomes, right, the schools, the communities, and every kid should own that piece. So I really want us to frame it differently. We've done this training many, many times, right? And I just want us to think differently. And also really be intentional. And I'm talking about, and you guys will be seeing it as it comes up, in our strategic plan, that's going to be on the refresh, there's a huge component about how do we engage the community and how do we have true, authentic, dual capacity engagement with our parents. So what data is pertinent for parents? Let me back up. For families, more PC there, right? And we need to be intentional. And it doesn't have to be this long list. If you say, hey, you need to know what our attendance rates are, because that's something that we did when I was at a K-8. Guess what? Let's cut the cord on all those appointments for kindergartens and first grade, because you may not believe it matters that they're there that day, right? And so that became part of our schools and our community's DNA. So they were taking ownership in it. So I want us to start really thinking about that, so we get the balance between process and true beliefs and values when we say we want to close some gaps. It sounds good on paper, but what does it look like in real life? So think about that as you go back now and start to kibitz and play with this a little bit. And have your list, because maybe it's different what you need for your PLC than what's appropriate for a kid, but we just need to be intentional about that. So it's not necessarily doing all that solo work, but being okay with allowing that kid to say, hey, here's where your I-ready score is. What is your plan and how can I help that, right? So everyone gets the share of that piece as opposed to we're trying to lift kind of solo as a school. I truly believe that. That's why I'm putting that in the ethos, and I know that it can change. And I'll just say that my science team did the work. In 1 year, I mean, they saw 17% of those, right? And that's their work with their students in terms of how they did that work. And again, it's relative compared to where you are, but the reality is they've never had that kind of growth before in the history of the school. So they can own that. So we're celebrating, but it wasn't a solo act. It's not a team, a person, a principal, right? And so how do we weave that into the fabric of the school? And that is the more difficult piece, because it's not clear and cut, because all students don't think the same. All families don't value the same information, right? And I'm looking at Mill Creek, and all languages aren't the same, right? We got the UN here. So it creates an amazing opportunity for you guys and for all of us. So just be thinking about that.
I'm gonna wrap up here, unless you guys have other questions or you guys wanna see the risk widget or anything like that. I don't know if the risk widget plays into your SIP planning.
Charts are not reproducible over time. You generate this chart, you come back in a year and you just say, hey, I'm gonna pull this data again. This may look a little different. So what I suggest is that you take your little clip tool and you clip out not just this chart, but this too. Just clip this out, put it into a OneNote. Something that tells you when you put it in there, somebody tells you the date that you pulled this data. Because this is that's your only way to capture this data for now. Homeroom is working on some tools to make it a little bit better of a data system for data for recording data. But right now, it's as simple as you could save the data extract. But even if you save this, it still is going to change over time, I think. I mean, you may be able to speak more about that, Deb.
It's a snapshot.
Save. Yeah. So you can save. You can experiment with this, the saving the data extract. Yeah. Currently, only administrators can. Brad is an administrator, so he should be able to look at all of this data. Yep.
Name's Brad. So is there a widget to do that you can access?
To compare all middle schools? No, not yet.
It's a work in progress, though. And hopefully this summer you and I can work on it a little bit.
Yeah. Actually, another thing I want to leave you with is that as you use Homeroom more, you're going to see more areas that you wish you could have to improve its functionality. If that happens, you can email either me or email School Data Solutions and say, hey, these are things that I would really like to see. And they'll put it on a list of suggestions that come in, and they're pretty good at tackling those, even though it may take several months to do so. But yeah.
Brian. So, we wanted to build in a little just brief time here. This is purposeful. And so we'll say 10:45. So we're going to give you the next 20 or so minutes because we know it's not going to get done right now. But this is the part that's just as important, because what we know about change / improvement is the conversation happens before the change, right? So what I'm going to ask is that you take the next 20 minutes and start to think about how are you going to give this life? How is this going to be different? And if it's going well, how are you going to improve it? And if it's simple things as what data you're going to use, but come to some kind of consensus on that, at least something you want to go and share back. But this is that important time where you start to have a conversation. You start to get an idea of team, but you also have to get an idea of principal's vision as well, and understanding that it comes right through our board superintendent down. So, you know, what are the two rules of the game and where are we headed? So we spend time focusing, going in the right direction. So we'll do that for the next 20, and then we'll have some time to share out. I believe definitely in given voice. For me, voice means value. And that's a cultural thing for me in terms of my own opinion and my historical references. So once you have that time, we're going to ask as a group, you just kind of share out what are you thinking about and what are you still curious about. Okay? So take these 20 minutes and have that time. Thank you.